Good evening. I would like to start off with a quick prayer. Let's kneel as far as possible. Our Father in heaven, thank you for this beautiful day, Lord, and for the wonderful weather outside. Thank you for the cold weather and for the opportunity to share some words with these fellow brethren of mine, Father. Please guide my words, send your Holy Spirit, and help me to minister effectively and say the right words. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I would like to start off with a quote by Ellen White, which says, "If we present and strive to labor in the bonds of Christian unity, one party will not be set up against another." I really like this quote because it is basically saying that if we would simply give up on our own ideas and work with others in a unified spirit, we would not have conflicts anymore. Conflicts are sometimes quite difficult to avoid. If we are unified in one accord, then it would be much easier to maintain a conflict-free atmosphere. Unity is a very important subject that I'll be speaking about today. Satan knows that it is important, and he focuses many of his attacks on unity. He knows that if he can disrupt the unity of the church and of the family and even of our own personal friendships, he can do a lot of damage. As you may have already figured, the main points of this speech are unity among the congregation, among family members, and among our friends. It is rather difficult at times to constantly maintain a unified atmosphere and friendship with others. Satan knows this and is trying to prevent Christians from encouraging one another in the faith. If there is unity, there is also a friendly spirit of encouragement and support for one another. Satan cannot stand this and is roaming about as a lion seeking whom he may devour. We should not be discouraged and give up, however. Giving up is exactly what the devil wants us to do. If we give up on trying to be unified, then there would be a lot of confusion and even fighting. Let's take traffic laws for an example of confusion. For those who drive, we stop at the red light, hopefully. But let's assume we all do. If no one stopped at the red light, though, there would be a problem, a lot of car accidents. That would be a very non-unified country if we can't even succumb to the laws that our leaders, whom we elected to office, created. Obeying traffic laws is promoting unity because it is yielding some of our own ideas in order to be unified. We sometimes need to give up on our own ideas and work with others in order to maintain equilibrium in the world. No unity, no life, quite literally. Unity in congregations is something important to have. The more people, the more power and opportunities to do good for one another. There is an illustration that demonstrates this point very well. I myself live in the Chicagoland area, where it gets pretty cold in the winter. And as the fall begins to turn into winter, there are many flocks of birds that migrate to warmer climates. Among these numerous birds, there are geese. Not just three geese, but a myriad of geese. They can be heard honking quite often as they fly in their flocks above our house, even when it's dark outside. Geese, however, fly in a very interesting formation. They always tend to fly in a V shape. Even what's more fascinating is how the stronger geese go to the front of the line and lead the way. They are not only there to lead the way, but to break the wind for the other ones. All the geese work together to get safely to their destination in one place. They care about each other and are unified. They don't protest against the leaders by saying that they are selfish and always want to be in control. No, they know that the leader knows what's best for them. They are very unified and work together in one accord. Like the geese, our congregations can work together and be unified by following their leader, God. The Bible says in Psalm 133:1, "How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity." If our congregations would be unified and work together, our lives would be all much more pleasant and less stressful. It would be like the verse in Psalms says, pleasant. According to the New Oxford American Dictionary, pleasant is defined as giving a sense of happy satisfaction or enjoyment. Don't you want to be satisfied and enjoy your life? The Waldenses were constantly pursued by their enemies to be taken to jail and sometimes even executed. Yet they were still singing happily even though they were being burned alive. They were unified and of one accord. They all worked together and supported each other in order to survive. They lived together in brotherly love. And they were very happy with their life because they were unified in Jesus Christ. What about us today? We have internet, fast, luxurious cars that can take us places very quickly. There is food galore, and we don't even have to worry where our next drink of water will come from. Yet, even with all the technology and benefits of our easy lives, we are still miserable. We are not unified, and we always find something wrong with what the other person did. If the congregation would be unified and work together, even if it means that there are times when one must yield to the other's wishes, our lives would be much better. We could encourage one another fully in Christ, support one another. Our joy would be increased greatly if we were unified. Then we wouldn't have as many stresses because of what that brother did or that sister said. There would be a spirit of togetherness. The early church in the apostles' time was very unified. They would get together and pray when someone was in danger. They would also pray simply for the Holy Spirit and to further the good news. When their unity would be occasionally broken because they were human, they couldn't minister quite as effectively as when they were fully unified. So it is with us. Unity among congregations is very crucial for our lives. It is our choice whether we want to be unified or not. God does not force anyone to do anything against their own will. The unity has to be propagated by our will. There will be an enormous benefit if we would ask God to help us be unified. Not only ask God, though, but actually do our part. Then God will see that we are sincere, and he will help us, guaranteed. Don't you want to ask God to help you? Unity is not only important for the congregation, however. Unity in the family is just as important, in my opinion. Satan knows that if he can disrupt the peace of the family, then everyone will be miserable and unhappy. I really like this story, which is a perfect example of family unity. Once upon a time, there were two brothers who lived on adjoining farms. But they fell into conflict, and it was the first serious rift in 40 years of farming side by side. They had been sharing machinery, trading labor and goods as needed without a hitch. Then the long collaboration finally fell apart. It began with a small misunderstanding, which eventually grew into a major difference, which exploded into an exchange of bitter words, followed by weeks of silence. One morning, there was a knock on the elder brother's door. He opened it to find a man with a carpenter's toolbox. "I am looking for a few days of work," he said. "Perhaps you would have a few small jobs here and there for me. Could I help you?" "Yes," said the older brother. "I do have a job for you. Look across the creek at that farm. That's my neighbor. In fact, it's my younger brother. But we don't get along. Last week, he dug a wider passage for water into his farm. But he ended up creating a very wide creek. And I think he did it just to annoy me. I want you to build me something so that we don't have to stand there and see each other's faces across that creek." The carpenter said, "I think I understand the situation. I will be able to do a job that will please you." The elder brother had to go to town for supplies, so he helped the carpenter get materials ready, and then he was off for the day. Meanwhile, the carpenter worked hard all that day, measuring, sawing, nailing, and building. At sunset, when the elder brother returned, the carpenter had just finished his job. The elder brother's eyes opened wide, and his jaw dropped. It was not what he had even thought of or possibly imagined. It was a bridge stretching from one side of the creek to the other. A fine piece of work with beautiful handrails. And to his surprise, his younger brother across the creek was coming to meet him with a big smile and arms wide open to hug him. "You are really kind and humble, my brother. After all I had done and said to you, you still have shown that blood relations can never be broken." "I am truly sorry for my behavior," the younger brother said as he hugged his elder brother. They turned to see the carpenter hoist the toolbox on his shoulder. "No, wait, stay a few days. I have a lot of other projects for you," said the older brother. "I'd love to stay," the carpenter said, "but I have many more bridges to build." When the unity of the family is disturbed, like in this story, then there is a very negative, unfriendly atmosphere. Sometimes siblings will even take it to the extreme and never talk to each other ever again. There are a lot of rifts created among siblings these days. There is rivalry and eventually hatred present if there is lack of unity. The siblings do not want to see each other or have anything to do with each other. They are cold and unappreciative of anything the other sibling does or says. All this simply because they were too headstrong and had an enormous lack of unity. This problem is not only among siblings, though, but in the relationships between the parents and their children. The children don't appreciate all the sacrifices their parents made, all the hard work their parents have put into them. The children feel like their parents are too controlling and mean, when in reality, their parents are just doing what's best for them. However, the posterity don't see it that way. They quarrel with their parents, and they reject them to the point where they leave the house and never talk to them again. The parents are left there, alone, with no more children, all their hard work wasted. All those long hours at work to make money to pay for their children's education, gone with the wind. All those long nights spent helping with homework, all the thought put into raising their kid, never to be seen again. This is a sad case of what actually does happen in some families these days. All because there is a lack of unity, a lack of giving up of their own ideas and thoughts, and especially a lack of God. It doesn't have to end this way, however. In this story, the brothers eventually became close again and loved each other. A lot of times, the Holy Spirit's working on hearts will cause them to realize their grave mistake. They get back together with their families and live much happier lives. Colossians 3:13 says, "Bear with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgive each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive." From this scripture, we get advice on how to maintain unity in our families. Forgive each other, work together, and especially never hold any grudges. Lack of forgiveness is a very good unity destroyer. Not only a lack of forgiveness, but a lack of the will to ask for forgiveness. If no one asks for forgiveness, then how can someone possibly forgive anyone? Sometimes it is very hard to ask for forgiveness to begin with, not mentioning the fact of the difficulty of forgiving someone that has wronged you. But if every family would readily forgive and ask for forgiveness, then unity would thrive in the family. Satan's work would be destroyed and the day would be saved. There is one problem, however. Satan won't just sit there and let families get along peaceably. It is aggravating for him to see a family where their parents love their children and vice versa. When he sees them all bonding together and working calmly to solve their problems, he is infuriated. He will try his best to separate families and destroy their unity. This is where prayer comes in. We need to pray for unity in our families. Satan cannot possibly defeat God, no matter how hard he tries. God will always win. Even though it might not seem like it at first, God can and will help us if we merely ask him. He can't help us really that much if we don't ask him in the first place. The reason being because Satan would go to God and tell him that he forced us to accept him. Satan would say that God imposed unity upon us and that we never wanted it in the first place. Thus, we ourselves should go willingly to God and ask him to help us. That way, we block Satan's efforts and make it more difficult for him to tempt us. So far, we have been focusing on unity that is mostly among a larger group of some sort, like the congregation and the family. But what about the unity that happens on a one-on-one basis? This is called unity in friendships. This can be a very sensitive subject because it is an extremely important one. Friends are a large part of our lives. We interact with them on a daily basis. Having friends can be very good for us if we have the right kind of friends, though. Jonathan and David are an excellent biblical example of a unified friendship. Let's look at that story from 1 Samuel chapter 19, verses 1. "And Saul spake to Jonathan his son and to all his servants that they should kill David. But Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted much in David, and Jonathan told David, saying, Saul, my father, seeketh to kill thee. Now therefore, I pray thee, take heed to thyself until the morning, and abide in a secret place, and hide thyself. And I will go out and stand beside my father in the field where thou art, and I will commune to my father of thee, and what I see I will tell thee. And Jonathan spake good of David unto Saul his father, and said unto him, Let not the king sin against his servant, against David, because he hath not sinned against thee, and because his works have been to thee word very good. For he did put his life in his hand, and slew the Philistine, and the Lord wrought a great salvation for all Israel. Thou sawest it, and didst rejoice. Wherefore then wilt thou sin against innocent blood, to slay David without a cause? And Saul hearkened unto the voice of Jonathan, and Saul sware, As the Lord liveth, he shall not be slain. And Jonathan called David, and Jonathan shewed him all these things. And Jonathan brought David to Saul, and he was in his presence as in times past." This story is a beautiful example of true friendship. Saul hated David because David was getting much more praise than he was. He hated David so much and to the extent where he wanted to kill him. Saul would have killed David if it wasn't for Jonathan, his best friend. David and Jonathan were such good friends, so there was no way Jonathan would just stand there and let his father do anything about David. Jonathan persuaded Saul not to kill David and saved his life. That is true loving friendship, willing to possibly endanger your own life for your friend. God had departed from Saul, so Saul was not exactly thinking very straight. In his turbulated mindset, he could have killed his own son, Jonathan, for simply daring to go against what he had said. Jonathan could have been killed too, but he did it because of his friend David. Jonathan loved him way too much to let him die. As we saw today, unity is a very important subject that cannot be ignored and pushed aside. Satan is always active. He will try his hardest to destroy the unity in the congregations, in our own families, and even our friendships. He cannot stand seeing us get along peaceably and helping encouraging one another in Christ. He will work really hard to destroy every trace of unity in our lives. But we have a solution. Our solution is God. He is always there for us, even if everything else fails. He won't fail us because God's real. He's not fake. I would like to end with a story. At the time of the Roman Empire, two Jewish boys had grown up together in Israel and become very close friends. After a while, they moved far apart, one living under Roman control and the other living under Syrian control. Yet they remained very close. One time, when the fellow from Rome was visiting in Syria, someone falsely accused him of being a spy. So they brought him to the Syrian emperor and he was sentenced to death. As he was being led out to be executed, they asked if he had any last requests. "Please, let me go back to Rome to settle my affairs and say goodbye to my family. Then I'll come back and you can execute me." The emperor laughed. "Are you crazy? What guarantee do I have that you'll come back?" The Jew said, "I have a friend here in Syria who will stand in for me. He'll be my guarantor. If I don't come back, you can kill him instead." The emperor was intrigued. "This I've got to see. Okay, bring your friend." The Syrian Jew was called in. Sure enough, he agreed to take his friend's place in prison and be killed instead if the friend did not return. The emperor was so startled by this arrangement that he agreed to let the Roman Jew go. "I'll give you 60 days. If you don't come back, off with your head." The Roman Jew raced back to say goodbye and put his affairs in order. After a hectic time and a lot of tears, he started back in plenty of time before the 60 days were up. But those were the days of sailing galleys, and sometimes you could sit for days waiting for the right wind to come. As luck would have it, there was no wind for several days, and his ship was delayed. And by the time the Roman Jew arrived in Syria, dawn of the 60th day was breaking. As agreed, the jailers took the Syrian Jew out and were about to execute him. But then the Roman finally came in running. "Wait, I'm back. Don't kill him." But the Syrian Jew protested, "No. You can't kill him. He came too late. I'm the guarantor. Kill me." Each friend was equally immovable. "Kill him. No, kill me instead. No, kill him." The executioner did not know what to do. The crowd was in an uproar. Finally, the emperor was called. In wonder and astonishment, he turned to the two of them and said, "I'll let you both go on one condition, that you make me your third friend." When true unity is present, we will be willing to suffer for each other so that our friends or family can be free. Our personal thoughts and our emotions will not be allowed to rule over the fact that our friends and our family need help. We will be willing to injure even our own feelings and possibly pride, just so others can be healed emotionally. This is true unity and true friendship, when you care about someone else so much that you put them before yourself. God longs to be our friend and be there for us whenever, wherever, however state we are in, no matter what we have done or who we are. Won't you accept his friendship today?